This video is sponsored by TomTom, the world's leading independent location technology specialist. Technology performs at its best when it's up to date, and TomTom wants to make sure your device is up to date in time for week number rollover. What's the week number rollover? Well, it's the reason many GPS devices might soon stop working correctly. That's happening on the 6th of April this year. We're going to have more on how that works and how to tell if your device is one of those devices affected in just a bit. Developed over the course of decades, GPS has become far more ubiquitous than most people realize. Not just for navigation, its extreme accuracy in timekeeping to about 10 billionths of a second has been used by countless businesses the world over for everything from aiding in power grid management to helping manage stock markets and other banking transactions. The GPS system essentially allows for companies to have near atomic clock level precision in their systems, including easy time synchronization across the globe without actually needing to have an atomic clock or come up with their own systems of global synchronization. The problem is that owing to a quirk in the original specifications known as the week number rollover, on April the 6th, 2019, many GPS receivers are about to stop working correctly unless the firmware for them is updated promptly. So, what's going on here? How exactly does the GPS system work? And who first got the idea for such a system? On October 4, 1957, the Soviet Union launched Sputnik. As you might imagine, this tiny satellite, along with subsequent satellites in the line, were closely monitored by scientists the world over. Most pertinent to the topic at hand today were two physicists at Johns Hopkins University named William Geer and George Weifenbach. As they studied the orbits and signals coming from the Sputnik satellites, the pair realized that thanks to how fast the satellites were going and the nature of their broadcasts, they could use the Doppler shift of the signal to very accurately determine the satellite's position. Not long after, one Frank McClure, also of Johns Hopkins University, asked the pair to study whether it would be possible to do this the other way around. They soon found that, yes, indeed, using the satellite's known orbit and studying the signal from it as it moved, the observer on the ground could, in a relatively short time span, determine their own location. And this is what got the wheels turning. Various systems were proposed, and in some cases, they were developed. Most notable to the eventual evolution of GPS was the Navy's Navigation Satellite System, also known as the Navy Transit Program. This was up and running fully by 1964. This system could, in theory, tell a submarine or ship crew where they were within about 25 meters, though location could only be updated about once per hour, and it took about 10 to 15 minutes to acquire. Further, if the ship was moving, the precision would be off by about 1 nautical mile per 5 knots of speed. Another critical system to the ultimate development of GPS was known as timation. This initially used quartz clocks synchronized on the ground and on the satellites as a key component of how the system determined where the ground observer was located. However, with such relatively imprecise clocks, the first tests resulted in an accuracy of only about 0.3 nautical miles and took about 15 minutes of receiving data to nail down that location. Subsequent advancements in timation improved things, even testing using an atomic clock for increased accuracy, but, well, timation is about to go the way of the dodo. By the early 1970s, the navigation system using timing and ranging, Navstar, eventually Navstar GPS, was proposed. This essentially combined elements from systems like transit, timation, and a few other systems in an attempt to make a better system from what was learned from those previous projects. Okay, so fast forward to 1983, and while the US didn't yet have a fully operational GPS system, the first prototype satellites were up, and the system was being slowly tested and implemented. It was at this point that Korean Airlines Flight 007, which originally departed from New York, refueled and took off from Anchorage, Alaska, bound for Seoul, South Korea. So what does this have to do with ubiquitous GPS as we know it today? While on his way, the pilots had an unnoticed autopilot issue, resulting in them unknowingly straying into Soviet airspace. Convinced the passenger plane was actually a spy plane, the Soviets launched Su-15 jets to intercept the apparently most poorly crafted spy plane in history. The old, it's so overt, it's covert approach to spying, apparently. Warning shots were fired, though the pilot who did it stated in a later interview, "I fired 4 bursts, more than 200 rounds, for all the good it did. After all, I was loaded with armor-piercing shells, not incendiary shells. It's doubtful whether anyone could see them." Not long after, the pilots of Korean Air 007 called Tokyo Area Control Center requesting to climb to flight level 350, that's 35,000 feet, from flight level 330, that's 33,000 feet. This resulted in the aircraft slowing below the speed the tracking high-speed interceptors normally operated at, and thus they blew right by the plane. This was interpreted as an evasive maneuver, even though it was actually just done for fuel economy reasons. A heated debate among the Soviet brass ensued over whether more time should be taken to identify the plane in case it was simply a passenger airliner, as it appeared to be. But as it was about to fly into international waters, and may in fact already have been at that point, the decision was made to shoot first and ask questions later. The attacking pilot described what happened next. "Destroy the target." It was easy to say, but how? With shells? I had already expended 243 rounds. Ram it? I'd always thought of that as poor taste. Ramming is the last resort. Just in case, I had already completed my turn and was coming down on top of him. Then I had an idea. I dropped below him about 2,000 meters. Afterburners. Switched on the missiles and brought the nose up sharply. Success. I have a lock on. Two missiles were fired and exploded near the Boeing plane, causing significant damage, though in a testament to how safe commercial airplanes typically are, the pilots were able to regain control over the aircraft. Even for a time, they were able to maintain level and stable flight. However, they eventually found themselves in a slow spiral, which ended in a crash, killing all 269 people on board. As a direct result of this tragedy, President Ronald Reagan announced on September 16, 1983, that the GPS system that had previously been intended for US military use only would now be made available for everyone to use, with the initial idea being the numerous safety benefits such a system would have in civil aviation over using then available navigation tools. This brings us to how exactly the GPS system works in the first place. Amazingly complex on some levels, the actual nuts and bolts of the system are relatively straightforward to understand. To begin with, consider what happens if you're standing in an unknown location and you ask someone where you are. They reply simply, "You're 212 miles from Seattle, Washington." You can now draw a circle on a map with a radius of 212 miles from Seattle. Assuming the person giving you that information is correct, you're now somewhere along that circular line. Now, this isn't exactly super helpful by itself, but then you ask someone else, and they say you're 150 miles from Vancouver, BC. Now, you're beginning to get somewhere. When you draw that circle on a map, you see that it intersects at two points. You now know that you're standing on one of those two points. Noting, in fact, that you're not floating in the middle of the ocean, you could at this point deduce which point you're on, but work with us here, people. Instead of making such an assumption, you decide your senses are never to be trusted, and I mean, after all, Jesus did walk on water, so why not you? Thus, you ask a third person, and they say you're 500 miles from Boise, Idaho. That circle drawn, you now know exactly where you are in two-dimensional space, and that happens to be near Kamloops in Canada, as it turns out. This is more or less what's happening with GPS, except in the case of GPS, you need to think in terms of 3D spheres instead of 2D circles. Further, how the system tells you your exact distance from a reference point, in this case each of the satellites, is via transmitting the satellite's exact location in orbit and a timestamp of the exact time when said transmission was sent. This time is synchronized across the various satellites in the GPS constellation. The receiver then subtracts the current known time upon receiving the data from that transmission time to determine the time it took for the signal to be transmitted from the satellites to its location. Combining that with the known satellite locations and the known speed of light with which the radio signal was propagated, it can then crunch the numbers to determine with remarkable accuracy its location, with margins of error owing to things like the ionosphere interfering with the propagation of the signal and various other real-world factors potentially throwing things off just a little. Even with these potential issues, however, the latest generation of the GPS system can, in theory, pinpoint your location within about a foot, which is about 30 centimeters. So, you might have spotted a bit of a problem here. While the GPS satellites are using extremely precise and synchronized atomic clocks, the GPS system in your car, for example, has no such synchronized atomic clock. So, how does it accurately determine how long it took for the signal to get from the satellite to itself? Well, it simply uses at least four instead of three satellites. This gives it the extra data point that it needs to solve the necessary equations to get the appropriate missing time variable. In a nutshell, there is only one point in time that will match the edge of all four spheres intersecting in one point in space on Earth. Thus, once the variables are solved for, the receiver can adjust its own timekeeping appropriately to be almost perfectly synchronized, at least momentarily, with the much more precise GPS atomic clocks. In some sense, this makes GPS something of a 4D system, in that with it you can know your precise point not only in space, but also in time. By continually updating its own internal clock in this way, the receiver on the ground ends up being nearly as accurate as an atomic clock, and is a timekeeping device that is then almost perfectly synchronized with other such receivers across the globe, all for almost no cost to the end users, because the US government is footing the bill for all of the expensive bits of the system, as well as its maintenance. Speaking of that maintenance, another problem you may have spotted is that various factors can and do continually move the GPS satellites off their original orbits. So, well, how is this accounted for? Tracking stations on Earth continually monitor the exact orbits of the various GPS satellites. With this information, along with any needed time corrections to account for things like relativity, frequently updated in the GPS almanac and ephemeris. These two data sets are used for holding satellite status and positional information that are regularly broadcast to receivers, which is how said receivers know the exact positions of the satellites in the first place. The satellites themselves can also have their orbits adjusted if necessary, with this process simply being to mark the satellite as unhealthy so receivers will ignore it, then move it to its new position, track that orbit, and once that is accurately known, update the almanac and ephemeris and mark the satellite as healthy once again. So that's more or less how GPS came to be and how it works at a high level. So what about the part where we said that many GPS devices might potentially stop working if they're not updated? Well, near the turn of the century, something happened that has never happened before in the GPS world. It was dubbed a dress rehearsal for the Y2K bug. You see, as part of the timestamp sent by the GPS satellites, there is something known as the week number, literally just the number of weeks that have passed since an epoch originally set to January the 6th, 1980. Along with this week number, the number of seconds since midnight on the previous Saturday is sent, thus allowing the GPS receiver to calculate the exact date. So, what's the problem with this? Well, it turns out that every 1,024 weeks, that's about every 19 years and 8 months from the epoch, the number rolls back to zero owing to this integer information being in a 10-bit format. Thus, when this happens, any GPS receiver that doesn't account for the week number rollover will likely stop functioning correctly, though the nature of the malfunction will vary from vendor to vendor and device, depending on how said vendor implemented their system. For some, the bug might manifest as a simple benign date reporting error. For others, such a date reporting error might mean everything from incorrect positioning to a full system crash. If you've done the maths, you've probably deduced that this issue first popped up in August of 1999, only about 4 years after the GPS system itself was fully operational. At this point, of course, GPS wasn't something that was so ubiquitously depended on as it is today, with only about 10 to 15 million GPS receivers in use worldwide in 1999, according to a report by the United States Department of Commerce's Office of Telecommunications. Today, of course, that number is in the billions of devices. Thankfully, when the next week number rollover event happens on April the 6th, 2019, it would seem most companies that rely on GPS for critical systems like airlines, banking institutions, cell networks, power grids, etc., have already taken the necessary steps to account for the problem. The more realistic problems with this second week number rollover event will probably mostly occur at the consumer level, as most people are simply not aware of the issue. Thankfully, if you've updated your firmware on your GPS device recently, or simply own a GPS device purchased in the last few years, you're probably gonna be fine. However, should you own a GPS device that is several years old, that may not be the case, and you'll most definitely want to go to the manufacturer's website and download any relevant updates before the second GPS epoch. Alright, so with that public service announcement out of the way, if you're now wondering why somebody just doesn't change the specifications altogether to stop using a 10-bit week number, well, you are not the first person to think of that. Under the latest GPS interface specifications, a 13-bit week number is now used, meaning in newer devices that support this, the issue won't come up again for about another century and a half. And, you know, as the machines are bound to have risen up and enslaved us all by that time, well, I'm just gonna say that that's their problem to worry about. So thank you very much for watching, and if you do have a TomTom SatNav or in-dash navigation system, make sure it's up to date by checking the link in the description below. Also, please do subscribe to this channel, new videos every day of the week. Also, hit that like button if you liked it. Thanks to TomTom for the sponsorship, and thank you for watching.